Hey, welcome everybody. Welcome to episode 193 of the Winners and Losers podcast. Is this a podcast? Yes, I think it is. I don't know. Yes. Okay, don't go down that road, Hank. You're just about to talk about 2010. We're debuting Tell the Truth, Cenk, part one, installment two of the rough draft. I think I fucked up with this whole project. People do seem to understand, but it would have been simpler if I just had, like, I'm putting it out in pieces and eventually a full movie. I don't know why I really tried to simplify the language out the front. I've called them chunks. I realized I should be calling them installments. Anyway, not important. I've got a different video format going right now. Why the hell is it so damn big? I'm trying to get my YouTube thing set up here, and I will be editing all this up. So, we got a premiere happening. I'm tired. I've got about 2.5 hours of sleep, 3 maybe, up all night, was really hyper focused on this thing. Poor kitty cat got neglected yesterday, among the reasons I need to find her a better home, someone that isn't just a psycho video editor like me who just wants to stare at a computer and be left alone. I could feel the synapses aren't all firing completely well currently, so I'm definitely gonna have a nice sleep later today. But worked all the way through the night. Some sound stuff I had to keep fixing. I was doing a lot of FFmpeg, which is like this command prompt thing. It's this really powerful tool program that you got to use these strings of commands. I know how to do wave, like replace the audio and to stitch videos together. It's the only things I really need to do. And man, it's powerful and it works fast, and it gives you a lot of flexibility. So I was doing all these little exports. I had to do the intro export, the outro export, and then like three chunks that I then put into the main piece. That's the 38 minutes that we're going to watch. So, I'm really excited. It premieres in 2 minutes though. Let me check on here. My face here. Let's get it a little bit, I think, smaller. I don't know why. Okay. Shrimp aren't even on right now, so we'll turn them off. Get out of here, shrimp. Better not be having fun or establishing social connections beyond your ability to reproduce. I'll allow them to reproduce. In fact, I'll even inspect how they live to make sure they are reproducing. That's right. That's fine. I need new family. I need new family. This is all just set up terribly. Okay, so we're going to premiere it. Do we have a chat? Oh my God, new managing moderators can support your... Okay, I don't have time to learn about moderators right now. I was up all night, so hopefully the file I uploaded has sound. It does. I literally have not confirmed that. I'll just retweet. I don't know why I think anything on Twitter is ever going to get me anything. I'm objectively, like, based on evidence, horrible at Twitter. After all these years, I've built like 1700 or 1800 subscribers, but people get on Twitter and they're like, oh yeah, we just start saying funny stuff and people, and now I'm a bit like, I just, it, whatever I do, my deal doesn't work on Twitter. It's really dumb. Here, let's just quote tweet it. Starting in a minute. Uh-oh, it just started. Okay, moderator. All right. Sup? Sup, John? All right. It has no clock, though. Oh, now it's counting down. Okay, here we go. We're going to start Tell the Truth, Cenk. In a second here. How many we got? Oh, wait. Oh, now it's counting down. Somebody got paid for this shit. What the fuck? Okay. Oh, that's the clock. Well, anyway. How do I see how many people? 14? 13? See, I kind of like this music now. It was stressing me out a little bit before.
You've already watched the first 46 minutes of Tell the Truth, Cenk Part 1. That's the first big chunk. If not, you should. It's in the description. Chunk 2 continues the story and starts momentarily. Consider these rough drafts. They'll eventually combine with the third big chunk to form the full version with everything polished and looking good. Slated for... no. End of summer's not gonna happen. New target, end of year. I'm doing my best. This project has taken years. There's so much more to do, but with your help, the story Cenk Uygur doesn't want anyone to hear can be properly told. And eventually, Part 2. Ugh, Part 2. I'll be sharing much of the production process on my podcast and whatnot, so stick around if you're interested, but please consider supporting however you're able. Donate, share, click the buttons, all that stuff, and join me in calling on...
I've only watched this through, like,
to
retract once.
The lie and correct
fully,
the
maybe twice.
Okay, ready? Chunk 2 begins now.
Reeling from the day's bedlam, Cenk seeks refuge in the harbor of a trusted friend.
We have a special guest with us. He's a candidate running for Congress in California's 25th district. Can you believe it? It's Cenk Uygur. Hey, Cenk Uygur, how are you?
Good. How you doing, Jimmy Dore?
I'm great. It's good to see you.
For the nourishing embrace of brotherhood.
Old friend, let us whisper of a dream.
Laughter.
Like, you know what I would do to them?
Understanding.
You are definitely not the choice of the Democratic Party.
You know what I would do to them?
Understanding.
Definitely. Sorry. Not the choice of the Democratic Party.
We're a little behind now.
To say the least.
And validation.
Right. No kidding?
That's right. Okay.
So that's great. That is great, right? So that's...
Jimmy, 1,000,000,000% right. So look.
Right?
Yep.
So...
Totally right.
It's exactly right, Cenk. It's upside down and backwards. Now, you don't take those bribes.
No.
The kind one only finds in the truest and lastingest bonds. You know, bro time.
So you feel that way?
Of course. Of course.
Well, that's how I feel. Well, how can we feel the same way?
Nothing heals more than a safe space to be oneself.
Christy, I know you're going to win. Nancy Pelosi's on your side. Oh, I disqualified Cenk. I disqualified him.
Cenk, you and I have had major differences on tactics, but we share the same policy goals.
Character assassination. When I win, I can't wait to disqualify them.
Aha!
To express shared interests.
The establishment. The establishment.
Establishment. The establishment. Kyle Kulinski.
The establishment.
Establishment.
The establishment.
The establishment hates me and would attack me.
Well, I welcome their hate.
Yeah, right? As FDR would
say. As FDR said.
And just dish about what's up.
You know what Latinos care most about?
No, what?
Chocolate milk for everyone
and yeah. More recess.
Yeah. More pizza.
And in an ironic way, I'm being punished for having an open mind.
I felt the same way when you founded Justice Democrats and these blogs that you had written back when you were trying to be Howard Stern.
Old blogs!
They've taken that stuff out of context.
I didn't believe in climate change 20 years ago.
You had evolved as a person.
You're totally right about my evolution. The first Gulf War, I did a pro-war rally. Real people know I'm honest. Like you, right? How did I do? There's no BS here. It's like Buttigieg on steroids. Mm-hmm. They cannot stop me. And it's driving them crazy.
Or talk about the other kids.
What did Obama say? Dianne Feinstein and Nancy Pelosi. Jill Filipovich. When Joy Reid had old blogs.
For me, this time it's Tulsi, Glenn Greenwald, Andrew Yang.
Almost as if you have a different agenda, Jill. But when Hillary Clinton goes on the actual Howard Stern show
to bash Bernie Sanders, I'm saying that it's a double standard.
Because Cenk was trying to partly copy Howard Stern 20 years ago,
yes,
he is disqualified.
The First Lady went on Howard Stern's show.
What a man. Are you against free college?
This highlights how they're pretending to be outraged at the things you said.
If they go after women's rights, if I'm in Congress, God help them, because I'm going to crush them. Reaching into your fallopian tubes, okay? I dare you. Obama said, we don't look backwards, we look forwards.
Which
it's not just nourishment, it's home. Cenk2020.com.
Except this movie has a different ending because I'm going to win. Cenk2020.com. And they never, ever want to talk about the issues. Cenk2020.com. Get out the way, yo. Get out the way. Cenk2020.com. It's a big mistake. Cenk2020.com.
Plus, Cenk gets to let loose a little and polish up that campaign charm that's going to take them all the way.
I'm going to put your name on a goddamn list, okay? A list of people who could buy weed. Every criminal in the country had to celebrate. Like, they're like, oh, we're not looking backwards anymore. I got great news.
The ultimate irony of all this, right, is that your policies, your positions are actually better for women than your opponents.
All of my crimes were in the past.
Stuff like this makes it very easy for me to support you.
Okay, I haven't committed a single crime in the future yet.
Yet. So would you try to stop Russiagating less?
So
welcome.
The previous Friday, Cenk appeared on a Brooklyn woodworking podcast to demand redress for what CNN literally did to him.
CNN literally wrote that I invited him on the show to share his anti-Semitic views.
Quote, Cenk invited former Ku Klux Klan leader David Duke for a segment about his anti-Semitic view of Judaism.
If what they're doing is trying to say that you're David Duke friendly, this is, they're scared.
Shielded by vagueness. CNN's imprecise wording, it could be argued, implies the KKK guy and his abhorrent views were welcome on TYT, which they weren't. Reporting this unclear is either sloppy or intentional. Or some might argue,
CNN obviously did a hit job.
They make it seem like he invited him to pal around with him and get along with him.
It's gross. It's negligent. It's horrible.
When, of course, the entire time, he was pummeling him into the ground and disagreeing with him at every turn and calling him out at every turn.
Cenk's right. What CNN did was wrong.
They're flat out lying about it.
No apologies.
I'm not going to apologize for the David Duke interview. I'm just not.
In fact, CNN owes him an apology. Literally.
Literally, CNN owes me an apology.
Cenk2020.com. I'm not sure if you're aware of that website, Cenk.
CNN and traditional media, they've declared war on Cenk Uygur.
I gotta fix that little hand coming up. It's a little wonky. It's fine.
CNN never produced the redress Cenk sought for the hurt he suffered. Cenk would remain apology-less.
I like this part.
Time pushed on, and teams Cenk and Christie got to work doing the hard grind of politics. Decorating HQ, giving speeches, accepting donations, putting out ads.
You ever feel like the Antelope Valley is getting screwed? Outsiders are America. My father, I'm new to politics. Soon he decided to pave a new path in his life. They take us for granted. He came to graduate school in America. And they even dumped their garbage here. That belief in the American dream is what led me to starting an online media company. Our district is on fire. If you're tired of getting taken advantage of, our housing system is in crisis. Let's change things. All we ever wanted was a fair chance, and that's what you deserve, because outsiders are America. and only you.
Just these endings. Valley,
and for you.
Why not?
Not on our watch.
This one isn't going to be a marathon. This fight is going to be about the issues that impact everybody in this region. We cannot thrive economically. Our state is on fire. All the things that have gone neglected here locally will persistently be a problem, and we are doing this.
Christy Smith is throwing her hat in the ring.
Media appearances. Radio, social, trolling the front runner with a stamp, local media callouts, pulling the old empty chair maneuver, tweeting about stamps.
I like that part.
Cenk phoned up King Hartman.
I got smeared immediately by the New York Times, LA Times, CNN, and just about every other outlet. And they wrote it like I brought him on to share his racist views.
Oh, jeez. I have interviewed David Duke.
He and Kyle had a nice visit.
When you woke up that day and you saw, you know, the New York Times piece, which said that you argued David Duke wasn't racist, which is just insane.
Walking and talking.
I'm Christy Smith, and my campaign is powered by the people in our community, not by corporate PACs or drug companies.
Parks, restaurants, fundraising.
So the New York Times wrote an article. By the way, CNN did the same thing. And so they say, oh, Cenk brought on David Duke to share his anti-Semitic views. Okay.
Bro vouching.
My name's Ben Mankiewicz. I started the Young Turks with Cenk.
Boss vouching. Organic media pickup.
Christy Smith was not looking good, and she continues to not look good in this district, especially when you look at her record, something that we talked about during our interview with Cenk Uygur on The Conversation just yesterday.
Also, this happened.
The political forum in the Antelope Valley got so heated, deputies had to be called in to shut it down. It was supposed to be a meeting about candidates running for former Congresswoman Katie Hill's seat.
But some argue it turned into a hate crime.
The don't degrade my president or his wife.
Well, Cenk, okay? For you, I will. And when I get
do
there,
not do that.
Kick his ass.
Do not do that.
They heard plenty, just not much, about the people running for that 25th district.
I'm an American, and I will say that. And you will stand down.
Reporting live in Palmdale, Amy Johnson, CBS 2 News.
Making good points.
I don't get it. Isn't it more rude to take the bribes?
Calling out your opponent for her ties to the health insurance industry while your company is run by a health insurance executive.
And things like United Health Group that gave you money.
Christy Smith took money from United Health Group, one of the largest health insurance companies in the country. And she says, oh no, you gotta trust me that United Health Group is in it for the public good and for charity. They don't wanna maximize profit or anything like that.
Smashing interviews, troop rallying, filing financial disclosure reports, paying Jordan Ohl thousands of dollars for consulting, hosting your for-profit daily news and politics commentary show on a variety of internet and cable distribution partners, deliberately inflicting material and psychological harm on your workers to resubjugate them. You know, the usual stuff. And we're back to March 4th, 2020. Intimidation Day. Remember this?
And to try to intimidate people here at this place of work.
Yeah.
Quick recap. Cenk's cars broken into. Anna accused of attempted doxing. Pelosi's ploy to start a union. That one's false. A lie. Made up. Not true. Bullshit. You and I know that. But let's offer Anna good faith that she believed it. Think about it. Her job as executive producer and host would be impossible if she didn't trust Cenk. So the perception that outsiders had conducted an external intimidation campaign against TYT was fair, and Anna's anger about it was justified, if not admirable. What she didn't disclose was that very morning, Cenk fired a worker from the bargaining unit. A brazen act of intimidation, causing not just direct material harm to an individual, but it's a classic union-busting tactic designed to dissuade others. It's a threat. Everyone under Cenk's rule was on notice. Obey or be fed to the tiger.
if anyone was intimidating people
at this place of work,
it was Cenk.
Yeah.
The tiger. I gotta animate the mouth.
In the 20 years that I busted unions, and I'd sit down in the client's office, usually the chairman of the board, the president, or whatever that executive committee or ownership of the company was, and I'd look for the motives in terms of union busting. You know, I'd look for bottom line or profit or cost. I'd look for all these motives. And in 99% of every company I represented, and I can say every company that my former colleagues represented, there was one word that was the motive 99 9/10% of the time. And what was that?
Control.
That's right. That's absolutely right. It's all about control. To sit and listen to them whine, it's about control. It's their ego. Because they were taught to believe that when there is a union, even a productive one, even a one that is contributing to the well-being, it's a testimonial against their management ability.
In one of Cenk's union-busting emails obtained by writer Alex Thompson, no relation, for the Politico article, the whoppers keep rolling. Cenk whines about the loss of his reputation now that he'll forever wear the label Union Buster, a label he could have avoided by voluntarily recognizing the union. And worse, he says, as a boss who treats his employees poorly. Poorly? Wait. A graduate of the prestigious Wharton School of Business treating workers poorly? Impossible! That can't be true. In the very next sentence, he accuses the workers of intending to harm him, proving the premise that he treats his employees poorly. Circuit complete. Ever the victim, Cenk then paints a scene of himself as beloved, terrible boss Michael Scott, duped by his workers into believing they were friends and family, only to be set upon by that dastardly union, and then suggests workers were manipulated by IATSE and characterizes their attempt to exercise their constitutionally protected First Amendment-derived fundamental right to collectively organize as fighting him. Stop resisting, says the capitalist. Now look, these emails are a rich vein of bullshit, but this 4 to 6 minute video I set out to make 2.5 years ago is long enough. Put a pin in these statements for part two. As someone who worked full time as a video editor, I received zero benefits for 12 of the 14 months my employment lasted. No PTO, no holiday pay, no healthcare, no bonus. So I can report that these statements are false. But they speak to the core of why we started this union and why Cenk has covered up the truth. He's scared. He would rather you believe Nancy Pelosi via her IATSE minions activated his idiot workers to start a union as part of her scheme to keep him out of Congress than the truth. In the article, Cenk defends these boilerplate conservative union-busting talking points. He meant every word. But the threat of his leverage over those on whose backs his success is built loomed large. It was well understood that there would be consequences for talking to a reporter.
Oh, shut up, both of you.
Staffers who spoke to Politico requested anonymity out of fear of retaliation, but expressed their support for TYT's role in the progressive sphere and a desire to live by the values it promotes. What a wild idea. In February, Dave Jameson in Huffington Post heard similar sentiments from a staffer who, despite fearing further material and psychological harm from Cenk, retaliation, expressed love for the company and a desire to live its principles.
What do you think you're doing?
Oh, gee, boss.
On March 5th, Hamilton Nolan in These Times spoke to an anonymous staffer fearful of retaliation about the retaliation workers had already faced and the NLRB cases they generated. Low pay was brought up, and as the lowest paid editor in the company, I can confirm. My rate was $21.63 an hour, way lower than the amount Cenk guessed was needed to afford housing in Los Angeles, and far lower than the actual number. You can't expect a full-time video editing job to pay enough to afford housing, could you? Can't help but wonder how TYT's unpaid interns get by. Negotiation was impossible, I was told. I had no leverage and even less hope that management would do the right thing. My choices were to leave or stand up for myself. Cenk defended his decision to deny workers raises they'd been promised, claiming doing so would prompt IATSE to accuse him of bribing workers not to support the union. I mean, like, come on, seriously? That's just fucking stupid. The same day, in the New Republic, writer Kim Kelly also protected a staffer's anonymity out of fear of retaliation. Not me, however. Because I was laid off in January, I couldn't be punished by Lord Uyghur for telling the truth to a journalist, so I expressed befuddled amazement at the managerial incompetence on display. Worker interests aside, principles aside, the lack of market awareness at how utterly reckless and irresponsible labeling yourself a union buster would be for a brand built on selling progressive principles was stunning. Or how an aggressive union busting campaign in which you publicly smear your employees might not score well in a congressional race based on the message that you're a fighter for the little guy. This buffoonery should be taught in business academies and bozo barns around the world. We needed this union for all kinds of reasons, but as the anonymous staffers who feared retaliation told Politico, centering his political ambitions in the union drive spoke quite clearly as to why a union was desperately needed. And Cenk should be embarrassed that the union was not his idea. Yay! The Politico and New Republic articles explained that, despite what Cenk wants his audience to believe, it was in fact TYT workers who initiated contact with IATSE first. In 2018, conditions drove a small group to reach out. That was the first seed, though a round of firings put the effort on ice. I returned to the company in late October of 2018, and considering I'd already had experience seeing the sausage made, was not surprised that working conditions were in need of improvement. Not just my own, but those around me. Cenk's employment practices were what persuaded us. We just held witness and supported each other in our common struggle. Having heard about the 2018 exchange with IATSE, I knew we had a contact, and I plotted to revive the effort in the spring of 2019. Conversations resumed in early summer and gained momentum until we scheduled our first meeting a week before Cenk announced. The feeling of converting solidarity into action is one I'll never forget as long as I live, and it's one capitalist ideologues like Cenk and his hand Jack are incapable of experiencing in their sad, vacant souls.
It is a barren wasteland, riddled with fire and ash and dust.
In 2023, remarking on Starbucks CEO Howard Schultz withholding pay from unionizing workers, Anna bores into how such a tactic functions to intimidate others.
And sadly, the union busting is effective because it dissuades other stores from organizing.
Cenk pillories his fellow union buster as a faux progressive.
Mm-hmm. And remember when he briefly considered running for president, he was painted as a left winger, as someone on the left, and they would use the word progressive for him.
And slams him for self-immolating.
Way to destroy your brand, well played.
Yeah, Starbucks. Way to destroy your brand. A bit earlier, Cenk seems to have learned that paying people properly would have been cheaper than hiring professional goons to help bully them into submission.
My guess is that at some point, Starbucks is going to look back at this, some other executive at Starbucks, and go, yeah, it would have cost us this to give them decent wages.
Right.
And instead, it cost us
this, like all the way up here,
yep,
to try to fight them and make us, and you're making yourself look like the worst guys in America.
The worst guys in America. Let's talk about it. Forgive the presumption, but I'm confident TYT's paying members would have preferred their money go into worker pockets and operating expenses, even cushy executive salaries and lunch budgets, than into the coffers of union-busting law firms. Denying rights is a lucrative business. The Economic Policy Institute reports that the union avoidance industry collects over $400 million annually with massive hourly and daily rates for consultants. Wow, that's quite a day rate. I made $173.04 in a day. Funding the legal infrastructure of capitalist oppression is probably not what most TYT viewers expected their money to do. Like this place, Mitchell, Silverberg, and Knupp. They brag about representing the AMPTP, Hollywood's boss cabal, who viciously battle and demean the WGA, SAG-AFTRA, and IATSE, the writers, actors, and production unions that entertainment and media bosses like Cenk would be utterly helpless without. That's TYT's law firm, one of them anyway. Like all bosses, the AMPTP benefits from the structural violence of coercion to gain leverage. Never more clear than when an executive stated they'd let the system force people into destitution, prompting one prominent union member to say this.
The motherfucker who said we're going to keep this thing going until people start losing their houses and their apartments. Listen to me, motherfucker. There's a lot of ways to lose your house. Some of it is financial, some of it is karma, and some of it is just figuring out who the fuck said that, and we know who said that, and where he fucking lives. There's a lot of ways to lose your house. You wish that on people. You wish that families starve while you're making $27 million a year for creating nothing. Be careful, motherfucker. Be really careful, because that's the kind of shit that stirs shit up. Peace out.
Yeah, that's right, motherfucker. TYT members deserve to know how much they've contributed to this anti-worker industry. Or maybe it's totally fine that the Home of Progressives helps fund
the worst guys in America.
And anyway, they lost. It was all a waste. Worse than a waste. Disaster. Eesh. Get that one star on Yelp there, buddy. You got hosed. A different decision would have saved Cenk so much trouble. Me too, by the way. Honestly, it would have spared me from having to make this goddamn awesome documentary. How this lesson wasn't known before Cenk pulled the lever is a complete mystery. Apparently, they don't teach these kinds of things at the fancy lad finishing school he is so proud to have attended.
Look, I went to the top business school in the world, so they're not going to get anything past me.
Hey, Genius Factory. Here's a headline for you.
Well, I can say Washington is not ready for you, Cenk.
Indeed, yeah.
With his political campaign in the morgue, Cenk's bullying campaign continued unabated. Not without pushback, of course. TYT Union's Twitter kept a light on for those seeking a trustworthy source of information. And Cenk's world-historic hypocrisy earned himself and his company a starring role in a montage produced by the Motion Picture Editors Guild Local 700. That's the one I would have joined.
We've got to have collective bargaining so you all have power.
The working class should have power. Are we allowed to stand up for working class people? The answer is yes. Yes, you are.
You don't have collective bargaining, and you want to go into your boss and say, all right, I'd like a pay raise. You're going to have absolutely no ability to do that. The only way that any boss would take you seriously is whether you could bring everybody in together.
Oh, this music over black and white, that means only one thing. You're the best. Oh shit, it's Haas.
Hello, Haas. It is your good uncle, Uncle Max.
Sexy Boys by TYT. Sexy Boys by TYT. Your dreaming house. This is you walking from your dream, from your dream. Sexy Boys by TYT.
Your dreaming.
Your dreaming house. Dreaming. Sexy Boys by TYT. Your dreaming house. By TYT. Dreaming.
This is you. You.
Your dreaming house. Sexy Boys by TYT. By TYT.
We need to restore power back to the average citizens in this country.
We need unionized work, right? We need labor protections. We had those protections. They've been rolled back throughout the decades because of the aggressiveness of the anti-labor movement.
The wealth gap is so big. The thing that had the most hope to close it was unions.
Finally, the second election was held, and the intrepid crew of TYT Union stood firm, despite Cenk's firewall of fame, bluster, and BS. With his grip loosened, Cenk's precious control reduced, the workers of TYT Union granted themselves a voice in their workplace, a way to address grievances, and asserted respect where none had been offered. The king's snarl became a frown. Time for coffee cake. Defeat for Cenk meant better lives for his workers. This, in turn, meant a better life for Cenk. It meant a greater ability to feed the nutrient cocoon sustaining his bloviating ambitions. For all the brutality of this effort, the workers would be more and more able to produce that sweet, sweet time, talent, and labor that Cenk, like all capitalists, require to keep the placenta pumping.
How much does it have to do with the CEO of the corporation?
It has literally everything to do with that level. It is that person who makes the decision. It all falls in the lap of that chief executive or chief operating officer.
Happier workers produce more. Rested workers don't get sick as much. Respected workers are more loyal. Healthier workers have more extra miles.
Study after study shows unionized workers make more money, have better benefits than non-unionized workers.
$68,000 for every single person working at those plants over the life of the contract. Extra $68,000. Now that's a win.
If you're considering organizing your workplace, obviously take a look at the possibilities.
Sean Fain said, I'm gonna be strong. I'm gonna fight for these guys and I'm gonna win. And everybody says, oh, you're not gonna win. No way.
And I think that it is a better way of improving your immediate conditions at the workplace, improving your pay.
Power never concedes without a demand. You need to make a demand in order to win some power for the average American.
There's power in numbers, and if you're organized, there's far more, I guess, you have far more weight and leverage in getting what you want from your employer.
We weren't against TYT. We just wanted to strengthen our own foundation, fully accepting of the inherent exploitation baked into a system that calls humans a resource, so that Cenk could continue to build his vaunted American dream upon it.
And I still want to be rich, and I keep that real all the time. I don't want anybody to get wrong idea on that. But
I want to be rich. I want to have a beautiful house like that. I don't have it because I turn down money at every opportunity to do the right thing. But would I like a house like that? Sure. Okay.
Congressman Phillips, Ms. Williamson, and Mr. Uger are each millionaires. That you're dealing with three wealthy people here. How can you relate?
Ben's uncle is an Academy Award nominee. His brother
winner,
is a...
Winner. He won. His
brother is a newscaster on 48 Hours.
Dateline.
Jill's parents...
He ran Paramount Studios.
Yes. Okay, and Cenk, I don't know. I mean, I don't know what your deal is.
My dad's an olive farmer.
All of you are wealthy. How can you relate?
When I was born in Istanbul, the hospital had to surgically...
I excluded you.
Or I had to surgically remove a silver spoon out of my ass.
I excluded you.
Yeah, I mean, look, I was not born wealthy.
No, my dad is actually not unwealthy, okay? So don't...
Oh,
you
right,
don't
I should include you. See,
my career has been one of great struggle as we...
Am I the son of a mill worker? And did I, you know, and this is the first piece, two pieces of clothing I've had that hasn't had a patch on it? No.
Being a talk show host is not easy.
Am I a part of the proletariat and I rose up and I just 3 weeks ago finally broke the chains off my legs? No.
For 15 years, I was basically starving. I ate Hot Pockets cereal.
Cenk's family far richer than my family.
Okay, well, okay, so let's...
You just sound actually far richer than mine.
Well, I think that's wonderful for all of you.
I used to apportion the amount of cereal I could eat at breakfast, lunch, and dinner.
Okay, you and I are fake broke, okay? Yeah, I drive the Pontiac Grand Am.
The legendary Pontiac Grand Am.
The old war horse!
This is the car that Dave Kohler and I drove across the country from New Jersey to L.A. to start the Young Turks. I don't know what that means. This is where we picked up a couple of Mexican girls and went to a Mexican festival in Dodge, Kansas. I hit the back, too. I forgot about that. Over here. Oh, you know what else happened inside here? Dirty, dirty things. No, I'm kidding. If you buy this car, you will help set this country free. You will help bring back our democracy.
Now, since I made that video, I've got some bad news for you. You know who else drove that car around for a while? The artist formerly known as Broton.
And it's not a pretty car, and I live in a one-bedroom, and I don't live extravagantly at all, right? But it cuts both ways. Number one, Kevin's right. If push came to shove, I am not going to starve. My dad's going to back me up. If push came to shove, your dad bought you an Infiniti, okay?
So do I know the pain of being poor and the struggles of being middle class? Absolutely.
All right, but here's the point. You guys are the elite.
Awesome.
Oh, come on. If you're not the elite.
And so look, on the economy, I'm fair and honest.
Signaling the cover-up that was to come, Cenk couldn't help but deceive the audience again with this tweet, saying they decided to join IATSE today is not true. As TYT Union stated honestly, and as you know, the decision was made months prior. Card check.
Look, on card check, I don't... So this is one of the issues that I'm not that progressive on. I don't believe in card check.
Not big on democracy. We got it.
His behavior, he might be a very nice, charismatic person, but his attitudes towards a collective voice of people is heinous, is not what we as a society are supposed to be about.
I don't believe in card check.
We voluntarily recognize the union. No, 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 you didn't. You were forced to. TYT Union used an honest term, officially recognized. Here, look, Cenk's mentions lay it out plainly. This contrast between a worker's honesty and a boss's lies is a story as old as clueless, greedy, capitalist fuckfaces have used their class privilege, solidarity disrupting technologies of division, coercion, and access to the state's monopoly on violence granted by ownership to gain leverage over those who just want enough to get by. It's a little personal, but I've struggled with mental and emotional issues since I was a kid and found getting by in Los Angeles difficult, to say the least. I couldn't find my footing, and times were dark. After a period without steady work, I was grateful I could afford to barely pay my bills and stay sane enough to keep barely paying my bills so that I could keep producing nutrients for Cenk and his treehouse of executive dipshits. Because ours is a society that sells help to those in need, I couldn't afford to fund a rich person in want, so I'd been neglecting my health and had been spiraling. My hope was that, thanks to the union, to collective bargaining, to the solidarity of my friends, that I'd have the leverage I needed for a few dollars more an hour, paid days off, and health insurance, which I intended to use for therapy and maybe have my butthole checked for prostates. I had no expectation of saving for retirement, building wealth, buying a place of my own, or affording a vacation that wasn't home to my parents. None of that. I felt a kind of shameful pride when a few months in, I was able to buy new shoes as I'd worn out my previous pair doing deliveries. I just needed the basics so the feeling of drowning might subside and I could stand a little firmer in order to keep Cenk's boot print on my back. I just wanted to be elevated to the same level of disrespect everyone else received. I mean, everyone maybe, who knows. You just watched the middle 38 minutes of Tell the Truth, Cenk Part 1. I gotta say, I came so close to making that guy fart underwater there, but that would have ruined the moment, you know? Ah well, maybe on the DVD. Thanks for watching, and keep an eye out for the completed film, due out hopefully by the end of the year. If I don't have to get a job, which I do, I'm broke as f***, I have to get a goddamn job. Of course, doing this kind of thing, a documentary about a former employer, is the worst thing to do for someone who has to go get a fucking job. I'm unemployable, so please consider supporting. Look in the description, there's a bunch of ways. So check out my podcast, check out my clips, give me a look, see if it's worth the trouble. Or maybe just throw me a few bucks because it's been several years of torture and this thing is gonna haunt me until my final breath. But more than anything, help me promote. I am terrible at it, so I'm counting on you. Click the buttons, leave comments, put it in your chats, show a friend, tell your dog, do anything you can to help get the word out that someone is actually calling out a boss for their rotten ass behavior. And together, we'll see this thing through. Honestly, I'm exhausted, but I know I can do it if enough people rally to my side and help me across the finish line. And this story's not over. There's more to come. Thank you.
I wanted to move to Los Angeles anyway.
Mm-hmm.
And my uncle was like, oh, this is an opportunity for me to hire someone and skirt some serious like labor regulations because it's family.
Sure. Mm.
Okay, so I'm chatting a bunch. Yeah, that's all I got. So yeah, I don't know. I told the people in the chat, some nice people in there. We got John Ross, Emo Dragon, True Tech, Dark Elements Games, throwing out some names, VLR78 and I just said Emo Dragon. Cool, man. All right. Well, there you go. First premiere. I think it got up to like 11 at one point, which is fine. I don't, you know, you can't expect like a huge whatchamacallit. So, okay. I have so many thoughts. Obviously, like I'm a million things running through my head. But I'm going to for sure keep the podcast going. I do want to check in, though. I noticed that, the Haas clip at the very end here is really jumped out at me when his...
I wanted to move to Los Angeles anyway.
Mm-hmm.
And my uncle was like, oh, this is an opportunity for me to hire someone and skirt some serious like labor regulations because it's family.
Sure.
Mm. Yeah, doing this caption, so you know, kind of maybe I should have put them all in one, so it's all there in one thing. But yeah, skirt some serious labor regulations. I was at TYT when Haas. In fact, let me find that. I was working at TYT when he first showed up. Like, I know he had ever seen him before. He wasn't the Haas that you know of. He wasn't the guy with all a million parasocial relationships who, you know, is all over the news and makes millions of dollars on Twitch and does good work. I actually never would have predicted that he would have become like, such a prominent figure on the left and in the socialist circles that he runs. And he gets criticized very intensely. I think that being in the public eye, being perceived that much and often misunderstood and misquoted and misunderstood and taken out of context and also properly contextualized too. I mean that in both positive and negative ways, but, That's got to be warping to your brain and stuff. So like I, you know, where Haas has ended up from when he first started. Not that I had any like massive thoughts about it or anything. I just remember seeing this really big dude. He was heavier. They talk about it in this podcast a little bit, and
I relate to that. I'm 6'3", and I'm carrying some weight. No, I'm joking. I'm kind of a big guy. Like, I played rugby in college a little until it became too painful. I was a prop, which is like the front row, and I was like one of our biggest guys. But that means we had a small team because dudes get way bigger than me. And so Haas is like, he makes me feel small. He's huge. He really is like a weird G.I. Joe figure guy. We make fun of his head, as you've seen the nepotism joke.
And don't worry, hungry capitalists. Socialist content is a proven moneymaker. Just ask the himbo-in-chief himself, the internet's top stream boy, where no take is too hot, no shoulders too big, no foe too paw, the socialist with the most to list, TYT's former head of the nepotism department, Haas Russert.
Haas, buy TYT, make it a co-op. Buy TYT, make it a co-op. This is you talking from your dreams. Buy TYT, make it a co-op. This is you talking from your dreams. Haas, buy TYT, make it a co-op. You're dreaming, Haas. Buy it. Buy it. Buy it.
That's just designed to try to get into his audience so that eventually he sees this. But he doesn't, his head is actually kind of large for a person, but his shoulders are just enormous. He's got this V, what am I getting on about that? But so the first time I saw Haas, I was like, oh, who the hell fuck is that guy? He's like big, and because he's like 6'5", 6'6", or something. And there was two dudes, and it was like Cenk's nephews, Haas's brother, I think. That was like 20, you know, probably late 2013-ish, maybe 2014 era. Actually, you know, we can jump back here. We'll come back to that. Where is it? A lot of times when I scrub this, I don't even know where the hell anything is. You'd think I would have it all like perfect. There you go. This stuff. Ah, there it is.
Cenk's employment practices were
back up.
Was not surprised.
I just did this. I just did this legend here like the other day, yesterday. Axe sausage. So this whole thing. In fact, let's back up a little more. Yeah. Okay. So this is the time which I first started working for TYT. And I definitely wasn't thinking when I moved to LA. I certainly wasn't thinking that eventually I'd go from selling my business, upending my stand-up career, thinking I was moving to LA to like maybe do some good work for the progressive movement and hopefully build out a comedy career. I moved way too early. I was starting to see how I'm getting sidetracked here, but I think if I stay in Chicago, I was starting to climb up the system there. Not that there's a rigid system, but like I was starting to get noticed a little bit by bookers at club. Like I think I would have developed into like a Midwestern regionally decent comedian in the Midwest. I still had room to grow, but I was showing some abilities. I really love being on stage. I'm much more comfortable standing on stage talking than sitting in the audience, which is probably a sign of some sort of psychopathy, but not really. I'm autistic as fuck. I want to be in control of shit. Not that that's what autism means, but like, yeah, being on stage makes me okay. All right. Sorry. Okay. So fuck. Haas showed up somewhere around this time. In this purple area back there, the freelance thing was, so I eventually was doing publishing, meaning I was writing headlines and stuff. And then that, they didn't have anybody to do it. So I did it for freelance for a little while after I quit. But, yeah, that's when Haas first showed up. I can get back into more of this. This is the Jimmy Dore period. I also did a couple of little freelance things for TYT around here. And I guess technically in 2016, I was also getting paid by TYT because Jimmy and TYT are still buddies. And so, like, we did some field shooting. We went to the Bernie Sanders. So, like, in it, you know, they paid me a little bit for some of that work. Because it was for TYT, you know. So, this part with Haas, maybe I should go into a more deeper dive on this eventually someday. I don't, you know, I'm not trying to spill any tea about Haas. It really isn't. I'm not even trying. I don't have it. It's just that I saw him when he didn't even do bro tips. Like, when he was just, like, visiting his uncle. And he was just this guy. He looked like a young person. Larger people, I think we tend to think are like older. Not that I was like, that guy's old, but you know, it's hard to be like, oh, that guy's a kid when he's like 20 and he's like fucking huge. So then he started doing sales, and he talks about that in this video here. So I kind of wanted to get into that a little bit. But when I found this, and I wasn't watching every single Haas interview in the world, you can do these transcription searches and look for keywords. And then see if anything jumps out. So this is but I have spent a lot of time watching a lot of this stuff. But part of the years of work with this whole thing was doing this kind of research. Is just kind of like hunting the internet. And during the pandemic, and I'm kind of a shut in anyway, and I've been in a mental state too, where I like being out, being in the world is very challenging. That's still very true. I'm beat up by just going to the grocery store. But let's listen to this.
So I interned there, and I wanted to move to Los Angeles anyway. Mm-hmm. And my uncle was like, oh, this is an opportunity for me to hire someone and skirt some serious like labor regulations as a family. Sure. Like I was living in the kitchen of a frat house.
Yep.
Because like LA real estate is insane. As
and
you guys
and
know.
His pit bull fish lived in your closet on the floor. I remember that.
Yep. I remember fish. He would bring fish to the office. Could have been better about picking up the poop, Haas. By the way, Haas, you want a cat? Anybody in LA want a cat? I have a beautiful cat. I'm trying to get rid of a cat. I'm not good about picking up poop either, so I totally get it. No, he seems like a good. I know he has his dog and stuff. He's a good guy. But yeah, so Haas was around TYT, and he gets into the ad sales job that he had, and it always seemed like, I mean, everybody knows that he's the boss's nephew. Like the nepotism is obvious, but it's also like, fine. I would take the nepotism too if I were in his position. Like, what? I don't think you can necessarily fault him for that at all. He's made a lot out of it. He's done really well. I would actually love to eventually have a conversation with him because, like, he knows me. Like, he might know my name, but he knows who I am. Like, he's definitely like would come up to me at TYT because he knew I was a stand-up comedian, and he was like an aspiring, I don't know what his exact plans were, but you know, at that age, at early 20s, you know, it's okay for someone to be like nebulously interested and just not even sure what the hell they're even, but just sort of sniffing an instinct of theirs, you know, like following their nose a little. He'd be like, oh, you're comedy. And like, he wasn't being a dick about it. Cause when you do stand up, guys who think they're funny always love to kind of come up to you and like, kind of like, feel out funny. They try to sort of be funny. They try to kind of ask about it. They might have a joke they want to tell. And he was doing that. And it was like a benign version of that. That can be kind of obnoxious a little bit too, but it's not. With him, I was like, well, yeah. Cause I was like really confident doing comedy. Like when you do stand up comedy a bunch and someone comes up to talk about comedy, you're like, yeah, I'm a fucking, like, I do comedy. Like even at a low level of it, like, yeah, I've given like over 1,000 public speeches where the intention was that people are supposed to laugh at what I say. And many of those, I didn't get any laughs, but oftentimes I did. But so we would talk about comedy every once in a while, occasionally, and it wasn't long conversations, but I could tell he was interested. And so I wasn't surprised when he started doing his own videos, but he had support. He had like help. You know, there was a producer that was there. So he got a lot of practice in a media environment that might not have been as accessible to him if his uncle wasn't an owner of a media company. So I don't fault him for doing that. And then he created, so he's going to get into it a little bit here. But when I saw this, I would like, if I do get to have a conversation with him, I would like to be like, your career is built on the labor of the people in this union. It's not just like a hypothetical. It's like literally directly the labor, the work of the people. There's so many talented people I know, including me, but not just me, who worked super hard on his breakdown videos to make it good, to make them good. And I did some of his breakdown videos. So like, you know, I don't think he necessarily owes them anything, although he should write a huge check to the primary editor. That would be cool. Just, you know, throw somebody $300,000, just a tiny percentage of your fortune. That'd be awesome. Cause truly nevertheless, it's a fair thing to point out. And I wish that there was more, acknowledgement that this union busting and the people in this union who his uncle attacked and smeared should be defended. And I think he did call out Cenk. I have heard him talk to Cenk, on his like Thanksgiving streams where Cenk is over at the house and they do like a thing and they argue about crime or something like that. And they get into some topics and things. And those are somewhat interesting. Cenk only brought up the union busting and Haas said, yeah, and I called you out for it at the time.
Anyway, people still think I'm anti-union, even though we literally have a union at TYT.
Yeah, that's true. They say, no, it's wonderful. They say I'm anti-union because they say you're anti-union, even though I was critical of you at the time. And it's like ridiculous, but you know, fucking people literally yell at me.
Hasan is definitely not guilty of his uncle's crimes. Let's put it that way. Besides which, we have a union. And they ratified, by the way, unanimously, which almost never happens. Because we have awesome benefits.
Yeah.
But I've never been able to find the video of whatever Haas said about Cenk in 2020 about the union busting. So I don't know what to what extent it was. I expect that he probably did. I'm not saying he made that up or anything, but like, I'd like to find that if I could. But these are like this union, though, these people are his, like his literal foundation of labor. And as a person with socialist principles, he should be acknowledging that more clearly, I think. I'm not one of those that calls out people who make money like in doing, you know, we need wealthy people. The whole philosophical concept of wealth drives me absolutely bonkers. But we do. It's fine. It's fine for people to have money. We live in a world with money. We live in a world with stuff. And any one person isn't moving the needles very much. He moves the needle more than most people, by for sure. He does a lot of fundraising. He shows up. He did a lot of good stuff around the IATSE writer strike and the SAG-AFTRA strike. He just recently was turning up at the student rallies for the pro-Palestine stuff, for the anti-genocide rallies and stuff. So, like, could it be better? Yeah, fine, sure. But it could it be a fuck ton worse? Could he just have become some manosphere douchebag on the internet? Absolutely. And he didn't. You know, and frankly, we need some attractive men to pull people on our side. That's why me and Haas should do a show. The attractive socialists, we'll call it. We'll call it the Hank and the Hunk, or the incredible Hank, the incredible Sulk. And the, okay, I'm going off. So what the fuck am I getting at? This is High Podcast, by the way, everybody. Sorry about that. I was stunned. Now, I wasn't thinking he was pulling in tons of money at that place. Nobody there was thinking like, well, I can't speak very well, but it's not like we were like, oh, that guy's getting 200 grand to bring his dog to work. Fuck him. It wasn't one of those things. You know, nepotism is one of those weird things. It's kind of hard not to be like, eh, well, you know, but also at the same time, we get it. Well, it's fine. You know, it's okay. People in their early 20s are awkward. That's when he did bro tips. Which, where Cenk refers to, this is stuff I edited just like the other week. Yeah, right here, young Haas, and Cenk brags that he did dirty things in the car he's trying to sell. Nothing like, hey, I had sex in my car. Do you want to buy it? Oh yeah. Oh, good. Better get a fucking discount for that. Yeah, right here.
Around for a while. The artist formerly known as Bro.
I should actually credit that because that's a different video. I just searched for the word bro tip on Tue's YouTube channel. So bro tip was like pickup artist stuff kind of, and like they drink, it was very edgy or edge case for where people are, and he gets dragged a lot for it. But who doesn't have a ton of awkward stuff in their early career? I don't hold it against the guy, but I was really surprised when I saw this, though, when he said that.
My uncle was like, oh, this is an opportunity for me to hire someone and skirt some serious like labor regulations as a family.
Sure. Mm. I was like, whoa, skirting labor regulations. Is that something a person who runs, I'm choosing my words very carefully, the person who runs the home of progressives would do? And this is his nephew. So it's like, what is that? What could he mean? I really would love to know what he's talking about. Was it like unpaid intern thing? Or I mean, I don't even know, it's a labor regulation. Was it like misclassification? Was he getting like a 1099 pay when he probably should have been a full-time employee? Was it, you know, that's like that independent contractor thing that you hear about sometimes? Was it like, I doubt he's like talking about bathroom breaks, you know, like the kind of other sort of ways that like labor, like, was he, I don't know. It's interesting though. Clearly he's recollecting not feeling totally respected. But if you go on here, sorry, I know I'm taking forever, but let's go through.
I was
this.
Living in the kitchen of a frat house.
Yep.
Cause like LA real estate is insane.
His pit bull fish lived in your closet on the floor.
Yeah. So I don't know Will Neff well. Apparently has a pretty successful podcast, but, these guys are obviously pretty close. They tell a story about like they've been friends for like 10 years. So they I think they live together. They're like, they're bros, you know, like Jimmy and Cenk.
Yeah. That.
I was basically just like living out of a frat house kitchen, like chef's quarters there.
We used to bribe our way into nightclubs with pepperoni pizza.
That's true. We did do that. Yeah. And I worked at the Turks, and I made like, I think my first year salary was like $21,000. Like, it was I got money back from the government. Like, yeah. The government was like,
I've made way less than that in the last couple of years. Way fucking less than 21. I have so much debt.
I worked at the Young Turks, and I made like, I think my first year salary was like $21,000. Like, it was I got money back from the government. Like, yeah. The government was like, you're so poor at tax season. I was looking forward to it.
That's how much you'd make if you were. That's around how much my buddy made when he was in the Marines per year. It's like
yeah. That's like a day of streaming for him now. Maybe. I don't know. Maybe more, maybe less. But yeah, he makes so much. I know that number bounces around, and Jeff Bezos gets a nice bite out of it. But Haas pulls in a lot of money off of Twitch and other things. But yeah, $21,000 his first year. So that's it's hard to live on LA on little money. I was making, as I said in the video, $21.63. And with overtime, I think I pulled in like 45 or so. I had some rent debt I had to pay back, and so I wasn't like saving anything. And the shoe story at the end of the video is true. Like, I needed shoes. I couldn't afford to buy shoes until I got that job at TYT, and after a few months I bought shoes. And I'm gonna get emotional even just talking about it, because I was so embarrassed that I couldn't afford shoes around age 39. And if you don't know me, the mental problems I'm getting at are that I didn't know I was autistic. I was having all kinds of crazy issues, and I have my entire life, but they were getting worse and things were getting weird, and I didn't understand. And that's a whole nother thing. So, okay, let's keep going though. There's a little bit more to this. It's fascinating.
Yeah. 1,000. Yeah. He's like, crazy. Well, at least with the Marines, like, I mean, you get room and board, you know?
Exactly.
So I had to make my own accommodations, but, that's how I started.
So he couldn't afford to pay to live anywhere. He's sleeping on the floor somewhere. And this guy comes from a wealthy family. Like, that whole family, he falls in that category. I have backup my family's nowhere near what it sounds like the T or Cenk family is or whatever. I'm not trying to compare that. Like, but I could go live at my parents' house if things get really bad for me. That's also not going to be a great place for me for my mental health, but I have that backup, and I feel guilty about that. Not a ton of guilt, but a lot of some people that don't have that. You know, it's horrifying. So, but I don't go around basing my standing in the world on the job my dad did before he went to college. I don't even think my dad did go to college, actually. But like, my dad did welding. I know he told me about doing well, like, as a welder. There's this place we drive by. He goes, I welded those railings. And then he never did. It wasn't like he was a welder in life, but it'd be like if I ran around saying my dad's a welder. Cenk talks about his whole video commercial. One of his campaign commercials all about how his dad was an olive farmer.
Outsiders are America. I remember when I came to this country at 8 years old, I didn't even know what an immigrant was. My father would tell me stories about his life, how he grew up as an olive and grape farmer in Turkey. He would pick olives and pull weeds out until his hands bled. Eventually, his hands calloused and he could work longer days. Soon, he decided to pave a new path in his life. After fighting for and winning a free education in Istanbul, he came to graduate school in America. If it wasn't for that opportunity that my dad received, I'd still be in that field. I learned the value of hard work while on construction sites with him. That belief in the American dream is what led me to starting an online media company out of my one-bedroom apartment. Doing that allowed for a national platform for the working class to be heard. Now it's time to get louder.
Before he went to college, and he went to graduate school, and his point is that he got a free education, and that's what allowed him to build the businesses that they built. So, yeah.
I just had nothing else.
His dad owned a factory in Turkey before they moved to the United States, and there was some political stuff going on at the time, apparently in the 70s, that, you know, so they came here and,
I just had nothing else that I could do that I would enjoy doing.
Uh-huh.
So I started doing ad sales at the Young Turks, and they needed someone to do like direct ad sales, and they had no idea. They had nothing. Like, they had no program dedicated to, like, you know, selling ads and inventory. So I basically built that out.
Right.
Advertisement, sales, and operations in its entirety.
Oh, wow.
And then I always wanted to be on camera, though. Mm-hmm. Because, you know, I'm a fucking narcissist.
Right.
I was like, I could do
this. Everyone in this room.
Relate.
Was a narcissist.
Exactly. Yeah.
Borov.
And so I was like, I will literally just like, I will fill in roles that no one else wants to do. Like if any of the talent, like the on-camera talent, they don't want to show up for work one day, I'll be the guy. And I was dog shit. Like I was so bad on camera when I first started.
But he would get more leeway to be kind of bad on camera because he's the boss's uncle. And he was a good looking dude, you know? And eventually it showed that he had some, obviously he had some public speaking abilities and he can string sentences together fairly well. I remember when he first started going on camera. Because remember, I'll admit, let's call it mild jealousy, but just more just like annoyed understanding that like he, like, because I was a stand-up comedian. And not that I was there to try to get on the main show or be a TYT host, but I had this thought that when you're a stand-up comedian in Los Angeles, you work in a place with a studio. I actually did a show at TYT, by the way. I know that I'm just thinking about that. Let me find the, it's called Infinite Clicks. And because we could use the studio at the time. Is it still there? Yeah. Okay, great. This is fun. Hold on. It's called Infinite Clicks. And I did all, these are all thumbnails I did. Me and my buddy Joe McAdam, who is a super funny guy. He'd come by. Oh, look, we actually got some views on some of these. Look, here's me and.
Hey, everybody. Big news out of Catland. Saber-toothed tigers. What was that big saber tooth for? Well, we finally have an answer. Are you guys excited to find out?
I ask this question once a week.
Yeah.
Me too.
And finally.
So, no one could figure out what these big teeth were for because it was obvious that they couldn't open their mouths.
You know, if I had a guess,
biting? The latest research. No, it's not. It was often suggested for intimidation mostly.
Okay.
Oh.
I just made that up.
No, I can see that.
I can see it too, but.
You see that hoodie I'm wearing? That's hanging on the wall back there. See it on the door? I don't want to go too far to show you the mess. That's the same fucking shirt. I was so thin and handsome compared to what I am now. Now that this video's out, I got to do a big push to get healthy. I've been just like rocking my fucking, like I've been like just biting years off the end of my life with the way I've been eating and not exercising. I'd go for walks occasionally.
It's chasing around squirrels. Squirrels don't get intimidated. They get scared or they get comfortable.
I would say it might be for mating.
Yeah.
Like
pinning down a mate.
With the latest research, they used some advanced computer modeling. What actually they figured out is that there's a different point in the jaw where it rotates. So it really was opening its mouth quite large, quite high. At least I think so. I didn't really read the
article. So it was for biting.
Yeah.
So here's the thing. They said that the original model for how it opened and shut its teeth, those teeth would get in the way and that'd be all messed up. They said there's no way that would be used for biting and chewing. But what they said instead is that they used it like a can opener.
Yeah.
Where it would just use its lower jaw to anchor and then it would bend its neck up in order to thrust those down into the animal that it was hunting for the kill.
Pretty brutal.
Yeah, and then in that case it would then rotate in a perfect 360 degree circle around the animal, creating a perfect lid. Mm-hmm. In which case, it
peel
would
it off,
feast upon
and then eat all the Goya beans inside.
Exactly.
God damn it! If I just kept doing shit like that, I'd probably have a fucking career. There's one of these that is really great. It's about sorority girls. Yeah, hottest. 2,300 views. That's a great intro. Come on.
This is Infinite Clicks. I'm Hank Thompson. This is Joe McAdam.
Hi, I'm Joe McAdam. And we're going to be giving you a little bit of eye candy today.
Oh, yeah. The top five hottest sorority girls in the planet. Joe, how excited are you about this?
Scale of 1 to 10, 10.
One to 5.
1 to 5, 5.
You could have said 10. It's more than. All right.
It's not my kind
Who
of
cares?
Humor.
We're going to get going here, all right?
Not
all right, here
joke.
We go. Number 5 of our top 5 hottest sorority girls in the world. We've got April. There, well, we don't have a photo of her, but Joe.
April's a sophomore. She loves flirting and getting good grades.
She's kind of a good girl, huh? But maybe a little naughty streak going on there, the flirty flirt.
Let's go to number 4.
Tori is number 4. She,
Tori is a junior, a self-described party girl.
Thought there was.
And she loves being spontaneous.
No photo for that one. She's a party girl. Man, I can tell you about some party girls I've met in my time, you know what I mean?
I don't like the tone that you take talking about women like this.
Well, they're over 18. They're,
it's, oh.
Number three. Let's go to number three. Here we go. Number three hottest sort of girl. Ashley. That's the way.
Ashley's a junior. She goes by Ash, and she volunteers at her church, and she loves her family.
That is so sweet. You know what they say about those church girls?
I don't know.
They like abbreviating their names. Makes it more efficient to worship our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ the God.
Ash, number
Ash,
three.
Good name. All right, let's check out. We're getting closer to the top. This is exciting. By the way, sorry there was no picture for Ash. I don't know what happened. All right. Anyway, keep it moving along. Top five hottest sorority girls. Number two is... Mumra is Lord.
Mumra is Lord.
Whoa.
Mumra studied ancient religions and enjoys conquering enemies.
Man, that's an intense woman right there.
Mumra is Lord.
Been around. She's pretty probably she's fucking crazy in bed. You know what I mean?
I mean the lack of respect that you have. First of all, it's a cartoon character.
Well, I mean, it's what you think.
I think it's from G.I. Joe. I don't really remember. Well,
anyway. Hope she gets a great education, finds a husband before she graduates. All right, let's keep moving along here. Our number one top five. Actually, you know what? Before we do that, let's recap where we've gotten to so far on our top five hottest sorority girls on the planet. Number five is April.
April, sophomore.
Loves flirting. Number four is Tori.
Tori's a junior and she's a party girl.
Party girl. Ashley goes by Ash. Another junior. Loves God. Number two, Mumra is Lord.
Mumra is
Lord. Conquers all who disobey. And number one, top hottest sorority girl on the planet is Danny.
Danny is a senior. She loves working out and dogs and talking about watching TV.
Shit.
Transform this decayed form to Mumra.
What?
That's even worse.
I don't understand what Mumra is or what Mumra's agenda is.
So, I think the real victim here is Danny. We didn't even get to see her picture.
Well, this has been a big waste. I feel like a fucking idiot.
Yeah. Well, anyway, hey guys, thanks for watching our top five hottest sorority girls on the planet. Let us know in the comment section below which sorority girl is your favorite. Don't forget to subscribe, like, leave comments, and share on all social media outlets. You can follow him on Twitter.
Don't, you're going to hate it, but drink Shaq soda.
Drink Shaq soda, everybody. All right, take it easy.
See? See? We're playing around. We're having fun. Let's get back to Haas here. Haas would go on air and he wasn't very good. And I remember there was one where he was making a point and Anna goes, oh, he kind of stumbled a little. And it's like, oh, he's trying. And I was like, if he didn't have his uncle's media company, they wouldn't let a guy. I'm only recollecting the feelings of the time. Haas kind of rubbed people a little bit the wrong way with the bro tip stuff and the nepotism stuff, but overall people kind of came to appreciate his role in the world. And like, and I used to say like, yeah, maybe there's a little annoyance here and there, but I'm glad he's doing what he's doing. I'm glad he's reaching the audience he's reaching, you know, and that's a good thing. And you know, it's a weird world how this whole thing has evolved over time. God, I wish I just kept doing shows and stuff. I probably would have kept falling into pits of horrifying mental distress, but all right, let's keep going.
Not much has changed. I'm still bad, but I was bad back then as well. So
a lot has changed. He's gotten better.
No, I've gotten a lot
better.
Let
me be that guy.
Yeah, I've gotten a lot better for sure. But I started doing that, and then I was like, I'll produce my own show. I basically like was selling ads, doing cold calls, all this stuff, while also simultaneously shooting a green screen teleprompter show. And they did not have that at all at the Hunters.
I feel like I saw that.
Like, the sales ad, and I think that's probably something people didn't appreciate there. Not that everybody didn't know, but like doing cold calls is brutal work. Cold calling sucks. You got to be, watch the HBO documentary, Telemarketers, by the way, just a note, just go watch that. It's 3 episodes. You'll binge it in 1 or 2 nights. I did it in 1 night, but cold calling is horrible. I had a job doing cold calling to fucking car dealerships to talk to the manager of a car dealership to talk them into an advertising program that was like funded through one of the auto manufacturers because it was some direct marketing company. I had to talk car dealership managers into saying yes to a sale on the phone. I think I got 1 or 2. It was horrible. And it was like a big bonus, like $1,000 if you get this many. And I was nowhere in the fucking, couldn't handle it. So that's hard work, man. I mean, that's shitty work. It is soul crushing, especially if it's not your thing. And it's not like he was just trying to be a good soldier and do what he had to do for his boss or for his uncle, you know? So I got to respect that. And I don't know what his record of sales was or anything like that. I have no idea. But let's see.
Out of a closet. Yeah.
That was in a closet.
That was a fucking
white background.
Yeah. That was a utility closet that we turned into a studio, basically.
Wow.
And then it popped off because I got on Facebook and they were like, you're just going to do all of our Facebook stuff.
Wow.
Like, you're demoted. No longer are you doing sales. You're going to do Facebook.
Well, that's because your uncle is letting everybody steal your sales deals at too.
That's
his uncle would like let him massage a sales deal to the last thing, then someone would swoop in and close it and take the commission.
Oh, yeah.
And his uncle would be like, them's the break. So it's
wow. I'm not trying to make a documentary about their relationship, but Jesus Christ, Haas, what the fuck? Let's hear that again.
Facebook stuff.
Wow.
Like, you're demoted. No longer are you doing sales. You're going to do Facebook.
Well, that's because your uncle is letting everybody steal your sales deals at too.
That's true.
His uncle would like let him massage a sales deal to the last thing, then someone would swoop in and close it and take the commission.
Oh, shit. Yeah.
And his uncle would be like, them's the break. So
someone would swoop in and take the commission. Like, if he's barely getting paid and then he's doing all this groundwork on a deal and then somebody else comes through. That's fascinating. That's fascinating. Man, what the hell? I mean, more information, please, I guess. Not that anybody feel like, you know, I don't know. That's, you can see why maybe he wasn't interested in sticking around TYT. Also, he was doing so much better on Twitch than he was, I think, getting paid at TYT. I don't know the numbers or anything, but like, I'm sure he was making far more just through Twitch income in 2019. I mean,
interesting because his uncle basically at this point, like, tries to whiplash this, like basically be like, I did all this to motivate you.
Are you on good terms with your uncle?
Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, I still love him, but I mean, he was
but it's insanity that he looks back at the situation. He's like, this was all part of the plan.
The thing is, like, I think they're progressive, right? So nepotism is a big no-no. And in order to like combat against like nepotism statements from within the company, he like went overboard with like the, you're fucking nothing. Like, you know what I mean?
Right.
I'm just going to do whatever I want. And
I'm just going to do whatever I want. Yeah, that's interesting, man. So there's a lot of interesting stuff in there. I just keep saying the word interesting. All right. Well, I'm tired, man. Thanks for doing this. This is like, this will be like an hour or something, right? Well, I've already got over an hour and a half here. We got Cenk. I love this. I wasn't sure what I was doing with this whole moon thing. I just had this really cool footage on my computer. This one.
Story as old as clueless, greedy, capitalist fuckfaces have used their class.
Now, using the word fuckface is probably poor strategy. Those cursing can sometimes send people into spirals where they hear that and their brain glitches out because they can't handle it. Oh my God. Everything you said is not accurate or true because he made me feel uncomfortable due to cultural programming about curse words. Curse words are so interesting. Isn't it weird that there's that? Anyway, language. Okay, sorry. So I'm about to talk for 20 minutes about the power of abstract information.
Class privilege, solidarity, disrupting technologies of division.
Racism, misogyny, all those other ones.
Coercion and access to the state's monopoly on violence granted by ownership to gain leverage over those who just want enough to get by. It's a little personal, but I've struggled
with mental and emotional issues since I was a kid and found.
So this is setting up later story part of this whole thing. And I'd rather not do this, but I learned I was autistic in 2022. And there's a whole more to this thing where the issues I was having and making this whole project was all related, not just related to that, but like within the context of a guy who was in very serious crisis with his mental health. I think my it's horrifying and upsetting as I am about my beard falling out over the last 3 years and who knows why. It's certainly connected to stress. It's alopecia of some kind. It almost proves it in a way. People have a hard time kind of accepting what you say about your mental health sometimes. I mean, they might just believe you if they trust you, or they just don't care that much, or they deny it. It's easy to deny somebody when they talk about emotional pain because it's not a broken bone. It's not a beard that's falling out. And this is almost like a physical manifestation that could be like, look, I'm having issues. And it saves me like hours of having to persuade somebody if I could just be like, yeah, look, I got a fuck. Like I have this like stripe that grows now. It just my fucking luck. The whole thing's not going to fall out. God damn it. Still have to shave my shit ass fucking face. What a nightmare.
Getting by in Los Angeles, difficult.
And so like I'm tying this into the story is like when you treat somebody with the disrespect that I was treated with. And I mean, no benefits, no holidays, no paid time off, no bonus. I was working the same job as people who were getting benefits. And that added to the stress that I was dealing with in life. And I was headed towards the autism cliff no matter what. Whatever life I had chosen. And I'm not blaming TYT for my hair falling out. I'm not saying that. But like, the thing that the bosses and people who take advantage of others, people like Cenk, union busters, the people that just want to use you, as Haas said, do what they want. I'm just going to do whatever I want. You don't like it, you can quit. It's not slavery, you can quit. So,
to say the least, I couldn't find my footing, and times were dark.
And so, like, doing the moon thing and then connecting it to other space stuff, I'm a big space guy, not, by the way, not bragging. And then it dials into nutrients, because I'm kind of using that as a metaphor for the labor and the time, the talent, the labor, and all that shit. These bosses are feeding on our cosmic energy, like in a very literal sense. The time that they harvest from you is this magical side effect of your existence. The protons in your body were there at the beginning of the universe, 14 billion years old. The more complex molecules or atoms made of protons from the beginning were forged when ancient stars exploded 6 billion, 10 billion years ago, seeding these clouds with heavy elements, forming again into another solar system, producing our sun.
After a period without steady work, I was grateful.
So I'm really curious if people are going to appreciate that this. I guess I'm going for a little bit artistic here, but
I could afford to barely pay my bills and stay sane enough to keep barely paying my bills so that I could keep producing nutrients for Cenk and his treehouse of executive dipshits. Because ours is a society that sells help to those in need, I couldn't afford to fund a rich person in want, so I'd been neglecting my health and had been spiraling.
And yeah, I was planning on getting out of LA at the time in 2018. I was like, I don't know what I need to go home. I can't get work. I'd done a few freelance gigs. I was super stressed. I had no health care. My shoes were falling apart from doing deliveries. And I'd done a freelance project in the summer of 2018 for TYT. I reached out to the editing manager, someone I like, you know, and was like, yeah, if guys ever got anything, you know, for me, I'd love to jump in and do it. And I did a good job on it, I think, you know. And then they brought me back in October. I'll get more into those details later. But yeah, it was easy. I love a job interview that lasts 60 seconds. Hey, man, you want to start on Monday? Here's the rate, $21.63. That's not negotiable. Yeah, fuck yeah. I'll be there on Monday. What time? See you then. Bye. Good. Cool. And that's the start of this whole story. So like tying in this kind of universal stuff was sort of just an impulse I had with the moon, the shot of the moon. And then I kind of was like, yeah, it is kind of a thing. Like, I can connect the sunlight. We feed off the sun, and the bosses feed off our cosmic. You are to them the nutrient. You are the thing in the sky producing nutrients for them that they, if you turn off, they stop growing and they die. Yet we're dependent on them to allow us to have health insurance. And the only way you can negotiate with them, if you don't like the way you're being treated, is you leave or you collectivize. You form a union.
My hope was that...
That's why the right wing rails about collectivism, whatever they even think that fucking means. I know there's like academic notions of what that means, but they hate it not because they hate collectivism. They hate workers having leverage over individuals, over people who have money, bosses. It's an old story. And the way we solve this, the way we get rid of it, is we get rid of bad jobs by getting rid of bad bosses, by getting rid of the concept of bosses who aren't accountable to their workers. Anyway, that's getting far ahead. Well, it's not going to happen in your lifetime or mine.
Thanks to the union, to collective bargaining, to the solidarity of my friends, that I'd have the leverage I needed.
This thing here is referenced earlier, right? Where Cenk says that no one ever raised a single issue. I constantly complained about the way things were for me. Constantly. Although you can't do it as much as you want to, because doing too much, you become annoying. And a lot of times I just did my work and got through the day. And I had a lot. I mean, video editing is one of those jobs where you don't get to fuck around. I mean, there's shortcuts, there's efficiencies, but it's not a bullshit ass job like a lot of office jobs, because people look at what you do. That's the point of video editing, is that when you make mistakes, people notice them. It's easy to pick up a small mistake. I mean, there's definitely all kinds of stuff that video editors obsess on that don't actually turn up as a mistake, but meaning to other people's consciousness. But video editing takes a lot of concentration, and I'm really good at it. And it's one reason I have the strengths I have is the way my brain works, which I understand through the lens of autism now, with so much more accuracy and compassion than the lens I was using before, which is I just couldn't understand my fucking whack-ass crazy head. I'm sure of ADHD as well, like hyper-thinking, hyper-obsessive thoughts, strange behaviors, hyper-verbal. And when I'm in a good place with that, I think it's actually a beautiful thing, but it can be really tough. Just a little horn tooting, but it's like being a race car trapped on a side street. It's like, if I'm on a racetrack, it's great. It's fucking cool. Let's let that roll. Look at that thing go. Look at that horse run. Change the metaphor. But I don't want to be a horse stuck in traffic. A stallion waiting for the car ahead of it to pull up a little. Anyway,
for a few dollars.
So Cenk saying that no one ever raised an issue. Not fucking true. I raised the issue a lot. I brought it up with the office manager. I was really unhappy with the way I was classified as in order to not get benefits. It made me very upset. And this dollar rate here, first of all, come on. 63. I'm worth $21.77. Let's be honest. I'm worth easily $21.92. I'm a pretty good editor. But this was lower than every other editor in the company. People who were getting benefits were paid more per hour than I was. That seems a little weird, right? Not that I would make a whole documentary or come forward about low rate. Not that that would be... crossing that line. I'm already way over the line in terms of what you're not supposed to do, this kind of thing. But just use that as a data point, as information about, like, wait a minute. So you were no benefits and it got paid less than everybody else. And this stressed out, and I don't like speaking for the other people at the company who I started union with, but I have confirmed this like directly with some. Because I'm loud and edit, we had to do each other's jobs, editors, because if someone was somewhere else, I edited main show a bunch. I did breakdown. I did Brett Ehrlich's show, Happy Half Hour. I did Jimmy Dore's Aggressive Progressive until it got canceled. That was a bit of an awkward reunion because we didn't end on great terms at the end of 2016. It was fine. We smoothed it over, but yeah, it could have been a lot worse. It was okay enough because I just didn't want to be stressed. So I was doing like regular company stuff, company schedule under company supervision, and the people I worked with also didn't like that I was being, that this was like this. It was not okay for, to them either. And again, I don't like speaking for, I'm not trying to, and they had their own reasons, and those, I often worry that this whole project is, might be causing problems for them. But, or somehow in it, because it's not, I'm not in the union, you know, and I don't want people to think I'm speaking for it, but this is the shit that Cenk is afraid you'll learn. And we started organizing this union in, like, I plotted, as is a screenshot in here somewhere, to start talking about the union, because workers before had reached out to IOTC, and then I was like, well, fuck this, man. I got to do something about this crap. I'm not going to just sit here and take this. This is some bullshit. I like this little part.
Having heard about the 2018 there it is.
plot to improve working conditions. Unfreeze the union. Wake this up. Get that Mr. Freeze ice off of that.
Change with IOTC. I knew we had a contact, and I plotted.
I really hope that people detect the joke that's right here on display, the Google search, where I type in
to revive the effort in a
cheap ass, and then I go
spring
back
of dash 2019. Conversations resumed in early summer and gained momentum until we scheduled our first meeting a week before Cenk announced. The feeling of converting solidarity into action is one I'll never forget as long as I live.
See, look on the sign here on this grocery store that I steal the coffee cake from. This must be so weird to listen to and not see it. There's a sign that says cheap ass coffee cake, but there's no dash. See, it's called setup punchline. Okay. But yeah, like the idea was I'm going to say some shit. I'm going to start talking to people, and we all, we knew each other. We're editors. We work so close to each other. We teach each other shit. We share tips and stuff and explain, oh, you're going to go on vacation next week. Okay. Let me sit with you for an hour or two and see how you do. Like I did the damage report maybe two or three times. And the kind of regular, routine daily editing is all pretty straightforward and simple. You know, you just got to make sure you're accurate. And, yeah, so it bothered the others though, that I was in it being treated in a way where I was not getting the same benefits as others. I wasn't getting any benefits for a huge chunk of this. Finally, at this point, I had almost full benefits, but they still denied the full accrual. It was like very close, but it still wasn't full benefits. Let's just jump back here, then we'll end the show. Okay. So yeah, this whole thing about wanting to, Cenk saying as if we're evil management that deprives their employees of the basics. I didn't get the basics, and I fucking needed help. I needed some health care. I really needed help. I mean, not that this was the entirety of all my problems, but
paid days off and health insurance.
Not getting all this stuff, aside from the actual literal material deprivation. Like there's days off, like Christmas, Thanksgiving, Christmas, like New Year's. They don't pay for Valentine's Day, do they? They fucking should. All the other paid days off. 4th of July, I didn't get paid for Labor Day. People I worked with did the same job, worked roughly the same amount of hours. They got paid on Labor Day, but I wasn't. No health insurance. The guy who tells a camera he's for Medicare for all. And I'm not talking about the first month. Sometimes you have a trial period. Okay, we'll get you all that stuff after the first month. Oh, that's a little bullshit. But the guy who says he's for Medicare for all, I was working full-time hours, full-time video editing, and I didn't have health insurance. So puts a lot of questions to whether he actually believes what he says when he talks about that. He would probably say that's unfair. I want the policy. I want Medicare for all. I want universal single payer. And I'd actually probably take him at his word on that. But when you work for somebody and they make their whole stink is about how workers need to stand up for themselves when they're mistreated. And you hire somebody who's been watching you since 2007 or 8, who happens to also agree and is a loudmouth fucking jagoff like me, with horrible boundary detection, and I don't give a shit about the fucking hierarchy. That's why this world's so stressful, because you have to acknowledge it. You have to honor it when you have to obey some rich asshole. I'm not just referring to Cenk. I just mean like overall, we like people submit within the hierarchy so well. It's that's a fairly, as I've come to learn, not that's unique to autistic people, but a lot of autistic people don't really kind of fit with, like, they don't really surf the same within the parameters that the world kind of expects you to, among the reasons why there's social dysfunction or why there's often like kind of misunderstandings, at least, let's say. So I kind of lost my train of thought.
Which I intended to use for therapy and maybe have my butthole checked for prostates.
That has no place in this moment, but it's just funny to use the Shawshank Redemption pulling back through the tunnel.
I had no expectation of saving for retirement, building wealth,
buying a place of my own,
or affording a vacation that wasn't home to my parents. None of that. I felt a kind of shameful pride when a few months in, I was able to buy new shoes as I'd worn out my previous pair doing deliveries. I just needed the basics so the feeling of drowning might subside and I could stand a little firmer in order to keep Cenk's boot print on my back. I just wanted to be elevated to the same level of disrespect everyone else received. I mean, everyone maybe, who knows.
Took a lot to get kind of look like he's actually the Hank character sitting at the bottom of the water. This is a Rocket League board, by the way, if anybody wants to know. This is there's a Rocket League board called, is it called Aqua or something? Yeah. They have two underwater ones. The other one is like a very colorful, like bright jellyfish and bright like sea anemones shit. So that one would have been a little bit goofy. Although there is a cool shark that swims around in that one. But this is like a danky Monterey Bay, like an ocean kind of like big kelp forest sort of dark. I did some color modification on here. So, wasn't sure if this was going to work, but I feel like that sells it pretty well. And then I really did want to put a fart, just a big old bugaboom, just a big blurpy bubble, you know, like an underwater fart is a real, real noisy event. It's just this sudden eruption of bubble, and the bubbles. That would have been fun. That'd be fun.
You just watched the middle 38 minutes of Tell the Truth, Cenk Part 1. I gotta say, I came so close to making that guy fart underwater there, but that would have ruined the moment, you know?
Why is that in the ending? That doesn't, like, that's not relevant. I want to live a life where I just make funny videos of guys underwater farting. What if that was my thing? Maybe that would be my thing. Just underwater farts, cartoon characters farting underwater. Honestly, if I did a whole simple 30-second animations once a week, that would probably just that would probably work. There's a lot more to say. I'm exhausted. I worked on this thing all the way through the freaking night. It took a lot of work to get it ready. I thought there was just more I had to do. I didn't even intend to the Sam Cedar thing. I really hope that they get a hold of it. I'm gonna email it to them at some point. But this little thing here where Cenk's, or the thing, yeah, right there. Watch the splashes when it comes out of the water.
Or some might argue,
CNN obviously did a hit
job. I did that yesterday. Fucking yesterday. On this huge marathon day of trying to get this thing published.
Make it seem like, might argue,
CNN
is either sloppy or intentional. Or some might argue,
CNN obviously
did a hit job. That's cool. That's cool animation. Why did I do that yesterday? That's one of the things I would put in like the final version, but I was just like, I really want this because I did all these shadows just recently, like these, like this whole sequence, each one of these little things floating around has a shadow. I'll turn the volume off so you can watch it. So the shadows really help kind of like your brain just calculate shadow. Our brains are very shadow oriented. That's why when you see something that's strange and you don't really know, you're like, look for the shadow. There's no shadow. Something's goofy. Although sometimes there's no shadow. Because for whatever alignments, there's maybe no shadow. So, I just fucking ruined it. I just ruined it. Back up a little bit more. So I'm exhausted. I was up till 5 or so. I honestly wasn't even that hungry. I hadn't eaten the entire day, and I had a little food in the fridge. And I knew that if I just went to bed, I would have been fine and woken up just fine. I've gone whole days without eating before. It's no big deal. But I still chose to eat and drink diet soda at like 4 a.m, which probably wasn't great. That'll send your system into a little emergency. But all right, well, yeah, so I'm exhausted, and I've covered a lot of ground here. I'd love to have a conversation with Haas someday. I think he and I would get along just fine. I hope he doesn't find the nepotism stuff and the kind of Haas jokes to be like full frontal attacks or anything. I hope he understands I'm playing with the concepts, and I do like the idea that he could just buy TYT. I kind of hope that, you know, he does. It's not going to happen. It's 0.0005% chance of it happening, meaning it's not literally zero, but it's as close to zero as you could pretty much figure. But he could. Cenk's nephew is far more successful than he is. So, yeah, that's fun. All right. Well, okay, good. We're done. I feel like I left a lot of threads hanging, but let me know if you feel like supporting. Throw me a few bucks for the years of work. If you're a former TYTer, you know, I hope to eventually see people asking TYT what's going on here. And is, I think, Cenk part of the truth that I want him to tell, aside from correcting the lie about that Nancy Pelosi is why we started the union, because that's bullshit. And he's using that story to prevent inquiry into, you know, the very basic and obvious question, which is, well, what made your workers start the union? Oh, and they did it in secret. Well, why did they do it in secret? Those are pretty reasonable questions that an audience, a progressive audience, should probably want to ask. But if you can muddy things up, if you have a story, a narrative that just like kind of papers over it, even one with the thinnest veneer, meaning like it's completely ridiculous plot to be like, all right, I know the plan. Let's trick those fucking morons into starting a union and they'll go for it. And then he'll say no. Like, why would anybody bet on him saying no to a union, even if you thought of that as an idea? We knew that he wouldn't like the union, but even we didn't think they'd say no. I mean, we might have entertained the notion of, like, I remember thinking, like, well, maybe we'll go on strike or something. But that was more thinking about after having a union going. It was like, how could the guy be so fucking stupid to trash his entire brand by becoming a union buster? Just, and I do think some of it is just lack of market awareness. And his main lieutenant is a health insurance executive who is like a complete corporate kind of goon, you know, and he's done public stuff and his LinkedIn profile is public. So it's in the video. I think there's something really gross about being a health insurance executive. You have to be a person of the lowest ethical character to be able to do that job. It's really stunning that we live in a world where, like, that's not a thing that the townspeople, like, Nosferatu up in the hills and the windy canyon road, but like inverse canyon, you know, where it's not like where the road's on top, but it's somehow it's like a tall canyon with the spiky parapets and the weird servants that chase him around and stuff. Nosferatu up in the hills. His kills in a 7,000 year career kills far fewer people than an American health insurance executive does in a year. That guy worked for, you know, Blue Cross Blue Shield and Kaiser Permanente for 12 years. So, yeah, my next documentary will be about Nosferatu. Okay. It'll be called Tell the Truth, Nosferatu. Actually, that's not a bit. I actually kind of like that. Okay, more to say, but yeah, throw me a few bucks if you can, but promote, or just even just a nice word. I love hearing people say, dude, keep going. I appreciate your work. That honestly means a ton to me. I'm about to fucking cry. It's been so lonely doing this whole thing, man. Some people around me, my roommate especially, is really tired of hearing me talk about it. The guy has so much patience. And he's such a kind person. I owe him so much money. But it still helps when people say, good job, man, because... fuck. It's really scary, this whole thing. It's fucking terrifying. I hate that this is where this whole thing wound up to, but I'm following my principles and I'm doing what I believe is right. And that's just telling the truth. You know, I'm sure Cenk would rather I made movies for him instead of about him. That's for fucking sure. This whole thing was crazy. This whole, I have a lot of video of it too. It's these links that are on screen. Those are, yeah. But I had to modify the sound. One of the sound was horrible, but I fixed it up. real good. So I have it all in a sequence. Maybe we do like a stream and we talk about it. So let me know. I'm saying goodbye again for the fifth time, and I'm actually meaning it this time. Thank you, guys. Goodbye. See you later. All right. Okay. All right. You can go have a good cry. It's okay to cry. It's a lot. It's okay. There's other emotions in the human soul and the human spirit. You're a constellation of wonders. So stop. We gotta stop letting the fucking bosses harvest our fucking energy. Okay. Bye. Goodbye. See you all. Bye. See you next time. Bye. Bye. Stopping recording.